नमस्ते बिटिया, हमेशा खुश रहो बिटिया। अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। माई सेल्फ जेवी एंड डॉक्टर रवि जैन, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ प्रैक्टिस ऑफ मेडिसिन इन फैकल्टी ऑफ होम्योपैथिक साइंस एट ज्योति विद्यापीठ वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी जयपुर। इन दिस सीरीज ऑफ लेक्चर्स वी आर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द वेरियस डिजीजेस ऑफ द हिपेटोबिलियरी सिस्टम। टूडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अनदर इम्पॉर्टेंट टॉपिक दैट इज रिलेटेड टू द गॉल ब्लैडर। We will be discussing about two topics, one today and one tomorrow, related to the gallbladder. The inflammation of gallbladder is known as cholecystitis. And if the stone is present in the gallbladder, then it is known as cholelithiasis. So these topics we are going to discuss one by one, one topic today and one the other day, that is tomorrow. So today we will be starting with cholelithiasis. Cholelithiasis means there is stone or calculus in the gallbladder. So many times you will find that there are stones or the calculus that is present in the gallbladder and the patient does not have any kind of symptom. And many times it is an accidental finding. You are going for an ultrasonography for some other reason of the abdomen and suddenly you come to know that the patient is having gallstone. Or if you are having an x-ray and suddenly you are observing that there is some calculus that you can elicit in the x-ray. So most of the cases that are coming to you of the gallstone, most of the cases are usually accidental finding. Although in some of the cases, you can get severe pain that is present with the patient. So cholelithiasis can have a variety of presentations and it's up to your consciousness that you are able to diagnose that given condition or not, whether you are able to find out that the particular patient is having gallstone. So you must know what are the clinical features, what is the etiopathogenesis, how to investigate a case of gallstone and how to manage a case of gallstone. All right. So all these things we are going to discuss in today's lecture. And in tomorrow's lecture, we are going to discuss about the cholecystitis, that is the inflammation of the gallbladder. So let's start with the cholelithiasis. In the e-notes that I have uploaded on the portal, I have shown you the picture or the picture of the normal hepatobiliary system, which contains the liver, the stomach, it is showing, and it is also showing the gallbladder containing the gallstones. So this is just a review for you to understand the anatomy where the gallbladder is lying and where we can think of the pain. Now, gallstone or the cholelithiasis, it is one of the most common disorder of the biliary tree. The most common disorder that is related to the biliary tree is the gallstones. All right. And based on the nature of its formation or the type of the stone that is present, the gallstone are broadly classified into three types of varieties. Three varieties which includes, we can have the cholesterol stone, we can have the pigment stone, and we can have the mixed stone. Now, it's your homework to go through the physiology book and to understand the physiology of the bile formation in the, we all know that the bile is stored in the gallbladder and that is required for the digestion or the emulsification of the fats. This bile is produced in the liver and it is getting stored in the gallbladder and then it is excreted. But if there is stones, why these stones are formed? Because if the bile gets concentrated and it is not released into the intestine, then it becomes a stone-like formation is there. And because of this stone formation, there will be a lot of symptoms related to the digestion. The patient will not be able to digest the food material properly. And there will be pain while eating or while taking fat, the food rich in fats. So this is a very important thing. And based on the nature of the stone, it is divided into three types. The stone or the gallstone can be of cholesterol, that is known as cholesterol stone. It can be because of the pigment, that is known as the pigment stone, and it can be a mixed variety that is consisting of the cholesterol and the pigments. Now, what is the etiology? Etiology, gallstones are more common. If you are talking about male is to female ratio, it is the gallstone is more common in the females than in males with a ratio of around 3:1. All right, and the age group, the most common age group that is getting affected by gallstone is the 18 to 65 years of age. That means gallstones are not common in the children or adolescents, but it is common in the adult population, and that too more common in the females. The female is to male ratio 3:1. Now, what are the risk factors? Risk factors are who are the people that are prone for development of the gallstones. Risk factor includes increased cholesterol secretion, impaired gallbladder emptying, and decreased bile salt secretion. So I have told you that gallbladder, it is a storehouse for the bile, all right, that we are getting from the liver, and it is then secreted into the intestine that is required for the emulsification of the fat. Now, when the gallstone will be formed? So gallstone will be formed, or it will be formed in those individuals who are having these three things. Either there will be increased cholesterol secretion, impaired gallbladder emptying, and decreased bile salt secretion. So the risk factor in the first condition is the increased cholesterol condition secretion. All those conditions in which the cholesterol is secreted more from the liver into the gallbladder, that can be seen in the old age with the obesity. It is secreted more in the females. Therefore, female are more prone for development of the gallstone. Rapid weight loss. If a person is losing weight very rapidly, then it will cause increased cholesterol secretion that will lead to the development of the gallstone and pregnancy. So increased cholesterol secretion that will be seen in the following condition: old age, females, obesity, rapid weight loss, and the pregnancy. Now, second condition is the impaired gallbladder emptying. If the cholesterol or the bile salts are getting deposited in the gallbladder, and if it is not emptied properly, then it will lead to the accumulation and leading to the formation of the gallstones. So impaired gallbladder emptying will be seen in case of pregnancy. It will be seen with total parenteral nutrition, in case of gallbladder stasis, spinal cord injury, and fasting. So impaired gallbladder emptying will be seen during the pregnancy, during the total parenteral nutrition, with gallbladder stasis and spinal cord injury and fasting. The third condition is the decreased bile salt secretion. When there is decreased bile salt secretion, then also it leads to the development of the gallstone. It is seen in case of pregnancy. So increased cholesterol secretion, that is seen in case of old age, obesity, females, rapid weight loss, and pregnancy. Second condition is the impaired gallbladder emptying, that is seen in case of pregnancy, total parenteral nutrition, gallbladder stasis, spinal cord injury, and fasting. And the third condition is the decreased bile salt secretion, that includes the pregnancy. So these are the risk factors that are responsible for development of the gallstone. Now, what are the clinical features? The clinical features that we are going to observe whenever a patient of gallstone or cholelithiasis is coming to us. So as I have told you, majority of the patients will be asymptomatic. So they are not aware whether they are having gallstone or not. So most of the cases that you will be getting for gallstone will be asymptomatic, but it can also present with an acute attack of pain that is known as acute cholecystitis. This cholecystitis we are going to discuss in the next lecture. So there can be inflammation, acute inflammation of the gallbladder due to the stone formation that is known as acute cholecystitis. And if it has taken a long time, then it will be known as the chronic cholecystitis. So the clinical features can include, they can be asymptomatic in the majority of the cases. It can present in the form of acute cholecystitis, and it can also present in the form of chronic cholecystitis. There can also be biliary colic. The patient can also present in the form of severe pain abdomen due to the bile duct, that is known as the biliary colic. And the pain will be sudden in variety, and it will be felt in the epigastrium. So the patient will complain of the severe pain in the epigastrium or the right upper quadrant, because you know where the gallbladder is. It is present in the right upper quadrant. And this pain will radiate to the interscapular region of the tip of right scapula. So there are the most of the patient will be asymptomatic. There can be acute cholecystitis. There can be chronic cholecystitis. There will be biliary colic, severe pain of the bile duct. And there will be sudden pain in the epigastrium or the right upper quadrant. And this pain will be radiating to the interscapular region of or the tip of the right scapula. There will be fatty food intolerance. As I've just told you, that because of this stone, the intestine will not be able to digest fats properly, and it will produce dyspepsia and flatulence. So in the clinical features, the patient will complain of nothing. It can be asymptomatic. That will be seen in the majority of the patient. It can present as acute cholecystitis. It can present as chronic cholecystitis. There can be severe biliary colic with sudden pain in the epigastrium, and it is epigastrium or the right upper quadrant, and it may radiate to the interscapular region of the or the tip of right scapula. There will be, the patient will complain of food intolerance, dyspepsia, and flatulence. This is the most common complaint with which the patient will be coming to you, and then you have to identify if it is a biliary duct calculi. So food intolerance, dyspepsia, and flatulence, these are the most common complaints with which the patient will be coming to you. And you will, if you are going to diagnose these conditions, then you will come to know that the patient is suffering from bile duct calculi or the biliary calculi or cholelithiasis. Now, for diagnosis of that condition, what are the investigations that you can do? So we can advise the patient to go for plain abdominal x-ray. In the initial stage, we can advise an x-rays. The x-ray will be plain abdominal x-ray. And the next investigation, the important investigation you can ask the patient to do is the ultrasonography. So plain x-ray abdomen, next we will have ultrasonography. Then it can present with the oral cholecystography. So oral cholecystography is another important investigation. I believe you must have gone through this investigation. It is mentioned in the beginning of the chapter. And with the other investigation, I have already told you to go through all the investigations that are given in the beginning of the chapter. So oral cholecystography, we can also go for, in the advanced cases, CT scan of the abdomen or MRCP. MRCP is magnetic resonance cholangiopancreaticography. So plain x-ray abdomen, we can go for ultrasonography, oral cholecystography, CT, and MRCP. Now, how to manage a case of cholelithiasis? Whenever a patient of cholelithiasis is coming to us, how can we manage such case? In the asymptomatic cases, it does not require any treatment, because we have seen that most of the cases of cholelithiasis will be asymptomatic. So they will not require any treatment, but we have to keep into mind that this can ultimately lead to the cancer. Therefore, it has to be monitored regularly. For the symptomatic patients, we can give medical dissolution of the gallstone by the oral administration of the bile acids, chino-deoxycholic acid, and urso-deoxycholic acid. So medical dissolution can be done by certain drugs, which includes bile acids, chino-deoxycholic acid, and urso-deoxycholic acid. Or we can also go for ESWL. ESWL is extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy, by which the larger stones are first of all broken down into smaller stone, and then it is dissolved. And surgical removal, this is the ultimate treatment, that if the pain is very severe and the patient is having a lot of complaints, then we can go for surgical removal. That includes cholecystectomy. It can be open or laparoscopic, by which you are completely removing the gallbladder along with the stone. Now, what are the complications? If this gallstone is remaining in the body for a longer time, then what are the complications that can be seen in such condition? The complication will include a mucocele that develops due to the slow distension of the gallbladder from continuous secretion of mucus. So a mucocele can develop if this condition persists for a longer time period of time, then a mucocele can develop due to the slow distension of the gallbladder from the continuous secretion of the mucus. There can be cholecystolithiasis that migrate to the common bile duct. This stone can migrate to the common bile duct, and it can lead to cholelithiasis and can produce severe biliary colic. So if this stone is moving to the common bile duct, it can produce cholelithiasis and will produce severe colic, biliary colic. The gallstone impacted in the cystic duct can produce obstructive jaundice. So if this stone is getting impacted in the cystic duct, then it can produce obstructive jaundice. And ultimately, it can also lead to the cancer of the gallbladder. But this is not a very common situation. So in the complication, the person can have a mucocele that can develop due to the slow distension of the gallbladder. There can be cholecystolithiasis. It can migrate to the common bile duct, that is known as cholelithiasis, and it causes biliary colic. The gallstone impacted at the cystic duct can cause obstructive jaundice, and there can be cancer of the gallbladder, that is uncommon. So this is all about the gallstone or the cholelithiasis. In the next lecture, we are going to discuss about cholecystitis, both varieties, acute cholecystitis and chronic cholecystitis. So I hope you must have understood this session properly. This session is powered by Digital Version 2.0 Jyoti Vidyapeeth Women's University. I hope the session is clear to you. If you have any query, please mention in the comment box and I'll try to resolve it. So this was all for today. Now it's your homework to go through this particular topic in the book and try to answer the question that I have given to you in the e-notes. So this was all for today, and we will be meeting in the next lecture with cholecystitis. So this was all for today. Thank you very much. Have a good day.